Eric Little, an athlete, a hero, and a servant of God. In 1924, he made a decision that shocked the world and angered many in this country. But the stand he took for faith on that occasion and many others in his brief life served as an amazing inspiration for generations to come. Eric Little was born Henry Eric Little on January 16, 1902, in Tianjin, China. His parents changed his name to Eric Henry Little after realizing he would have a hard time at school due to his initials, H-E-L. James Little, his father, was a missionary from Scotland. He married Mary Redden, and they had four children. The oldest was Robert, or Robbie as he preferred. Eric was the second, followed by Jenny and then Ernest. The Little children grew up just as much Chinese as English. They learned the language, songs, food, and other aspects of Chinese culture. It was a background that would serve Eric well later in life. Eric once got sick when he was young, and his legs stiffened and had to be massaged by the hour. A visitor told his mother he would never be able to run again, but as time would demonstrate, this prediction was quite inaccurate. The Littles returned to Scotland on furlough when Eric was five. After about a year, James returned to China as a missionary, and Eric and Robbie were enrolled into a London boarding school for missionary sons. Mary and Jenny stayed nearby for a year before rejoining James in China. The school, which became known as Eltham College in 1912, was home for Eric until 1920. There he was on the rugby and track teams, and he often competed with his brother Robbie for top place in athletic events. After graduating from Eltham, Eric moved to Edinburgh, Scotland in 1920. He enrolled in the University of Edinburgh in 1921. Athletics was a big part of his college experience. He ran his first public races at the Edinburgh University Sports Ground in May 1921. He was not running against his old familiar foe, his brother Robbie, but against a sprint champion named G.N.E. Stewart. Eric won the 100-yard final and finished a close second in the 220-yard final. Eric was a very messy runner. He threw his head back, his knees hit his chest, and his arms flew around everywhere. His coach thought he looked like a circus pony. But Eric's performance and speed at this first race caused him to be chosen to run for the Edinburgh team. Eric worked with a trainer named Tom Kircher, and under this guidance, he went on to win many races. As early as 1921, newspapers were writing about Eric and the possibility of him becoming an Olympic runner. In 1922, he was selected as a member of the Scottish International Rugby team. Mainly because of his running, he became one of the most famous athletes in Scotland. As well as athletics were going for Eric, he wanted to be a part of something bigger. He wanted to be of service in the kingdom of God, but he didn't know how, especially since he was terrified of public speaking. He said a prayer to God and told him that he would do anything for him. The opportunity came days later. In April 1923, D.P. Thompson, a man with a group known as the Glasgow Students Evangelist Union, invited Eric to speak to a group in the town of Armidale about his faith in Christ. Eric agreed and went on to speak to a group of about 80 men. His willingness to overcome his fear and his commitment to share his faith in Christ was a turning point in his life. Although he was not a very good speaker by most measures, people still loved to hear him because of his humility and sincerity. During 1923, Eric participated in many races in an effort to qualify for the British Olympic team. One of Eric's most famous races was at the 1924 Triangular International involving England, Scotland, and Ireland. Eric won the 100-yard race and the 220-yard race. Only one sprint remained, the 440-yard race, but at the beginning of the 440 final, Eric was tripped and fell. He paused while the others moved on until a judge shouted for him to go on. He got up and was 20 yards behind the pack, but he ran furiously and pulled ahead at the last to win the race. His victory allowed Scotland the overall victory by half a point. People say it was impossible, but not for Eric Little. The 1924 Olympics were in Paris, France. Eric's best event was the 100-meter dash, and he was considered a favorite in that event. Scotland had never won a gold medal in the 100 meters, and it was counting on Little to win. But in November 1923, the members of the team were given a schedule of events, and some of the preliminary heats were scheduled on a Sunday. Eric considered his Sabbath to be Sunday and felt it would be dishonorable to God to race that day. Neil Campbell, one of Eric's fellow athletes, described Eric's decision not to participate in the 100 meters at the Olympics, as well as two relay races that involved racing on Sunday. It was all very quiet. Little was the last person to make a song and dance about that sort of thing. He just said, "I'm not running on Sunday," and that was that. And he would have been upset if anything much had been made of it at the time. We thought it was completely in character, and a lot of the athletes were quietly impressed by it. They felt that here was a man who was prepared to stand for what he thought was right, without interfering with anyone else, and without being dogmatic or anything like that. Greville Young was a student who roomed with Eric in Edinburgh, and explained that many weren't happy that Eric would not run. It caused a tremendous furor among many people, particularly the newspapers. I remember how they came to the George Square Hostel and hammered on the door and demanded to see him. On one occasion, it was my job to go and try to clear them off, but they were quite menacing. There were cries of, "He's a traitor to his country," but Eric just accepted these things. I never remember him being upset. He said, "It's just my belief. I don't ever criticize others about it, but I'm not going to run on the Sunday." Britain's appeals to the Olympic Committee to move the races from Sunday were rejected, but there were two other events that had no races on Sunday, the 200 meter and the 400 meter. The 400 meter was one of the most demanding races, and Eric did not consider it his specialty, but he committed himself to training, and he made the final Olympic roster for the 200 meter and the 400 meter. Harold Abrahams, Eric's British teammate, went on to win the gold medal in the 100 meter. Eric was happy for Abrahams. Both Eric and Harold qualified for the 200 meter, and Eric won the bronze. This was a success for Scotland because it had never won a medal in the 200 meter. Eric qualified for the finals in the 400 meter. On the morning of July 11th, as Eric was leaving his hotel, one of the British team masseurs gave Eric a note. Eric told him he would read it at the stadium. When Eric opened the note, it read, "It says in the old book, him that honors me, I will honor. Wishing you the best of success always." It was a great encouragement to Eric. He lined up for the finals, running in the far outside lane. Eric Little was a champion. He just made history and won the gold. Years later, he said this, "The secret of my success over the 400 meters is that I run the first 200 meters as hard as I can. Then for the second 200 meters, with God's help, I run harder." He returned home a national hero. When he graduated from Edinburgh, his classmates picked him up and carried him through the streets. Eric's success gave him the opening to speak about his faith again. Though some would bask in the fame and prepare for the next Olympics, he had greater opportunities in mind. He moved to China in 1925 to teach at a missionary school, and he became an ordained minister in 1932. While in China, he met the love of his life, Florence McKenzie. He and Florence were married in 1934, and they quickly had two daughters, Patricia and Heather. Eric enjoyed the ministry, and he touched countless lives with his teaching and joyful spirit. But it was not without difficulties, especially during the late 1930s when Japan went to war with China, a conflict that continued throughout World War II. Eventually, Eric became concerned about the safety of his family, and in May 1941, he decided to send his daughters and Flo, who was expecting their third daughter, to Canada. When Eric sent them off to the ship, he told his oldest daughter, Patricia, "You're a big girl now, Tricia. I want you to take care of Mummy, Heather, and the new baby that's coming. Promise?" She nodded and said, "Promise, Daddy." Eric would never see his family again and would never see his third daughter, Maureen. In 1943, Eric was transported by Japanese guards to an internment camp at Weishin. The kids of the internment camp, for whom he organized many games, loved him and called him Uncle Eric. His meek and cheerful spirit made him beloved by all, even Japanese aggressors. While at the internment camp, he cared for the elderly, the weak, and the ill, and he made multiple sacrifices for others. He gave his cherished running shoes to another man who didn't have a working pair of shoes. He even gave his chance to leave the internment camp, which he received due to his fame, to an expecting woman. Eric Little fell ill from what was later determined to be a brain tumor. His final words were, "It's complete surrender." He died on February 21st, 1945. The legacy left by his memorable stand at the 1924 Olympics inspired the 1981 Academy Award-winning motion picture, Chariots of Fire. But more importantly, his willingness to stand for his faith throughout his life continues to inspire people today, reminding us to stand for our honest convictions even when others may disagree, even when another way may be more comfortable.